Hey, Doc Squad, Dr. White here with the Business Analysis Doctor. Today, I'm giving you a tutorial on use case diagrams. But before we get started, if you want more business analysis training and tips, be sure to subscribe to the page and turn on the notification bell. With that said, let's get started. So let's talk about what you're going to learn today. We're going to go over what is a use case, the main components of a use case diagram. Then we'll look at an example of how to navigate and interpret a use case diagram. And then we'll look at some use case diagram best practices. So what is a use case? A use case is a functionality within a system that will allow the user to achieve a goal. Now, a use case diagram is a visual representation of the relationships between actors and key use cases within a solution. It also depicts the scope of that solution. Now, the standard notation for the use case diagram is a part of the unified modeling language. The main components of a use case include the system boundary box, the system name, actors, use cases, associations, relationships, and goals. Now let's look at each of these in more detail. So the system boundary box represents the boundary of a system or solution. It's presented as a large rectangular box surrounding the use case. Any use case inside of the rectangle is considered to be within scope, and any use case outside of that rectangle is considered to be out of scope. Then we have the system name. The system name represents the name of the system or solution being defined. It's located at the top center of the system boundary box. Now we have our actors. Actor is any person or system that uses or interacts with the use case in order to achieve a goal. Each actor is given a role to represent their interaction with the solution. Now, the name of human actors should always be in the form of a role and should not specify an actual name. Also, actors must interact with at least one use case. Now, actors can be in the form of a human or an external system. When they are in the form of a human, they are represented with this little stick figure here. But when actors are external systems, they're represented with smaller boxes. Generally, there are two types of actors, primary and secondary. Primary actors are located on the left side of the system boundary box, while secondary actors are located on the right side of the system boundary box. The next component is the actual use cases. A use case is the action taken by an actor in order to complete or accomplish a task. Each use case should map to a functional requirement. Now, use cases are represented by a horizontal oval. And use case names should generally include a verb that describes an action and a noun that describes an element that is being impacted by the use case. Next, we have associations. Association shows the interaction between actors and the use cases. An association line indicates the actor's ability to perform functionality within a use case. One thing to note is that only primary actors can initiate use cases. Secondary actors can only react to a use case. Generally, there will only be association lines between actors and base use cases, not with any sub use cases. Now, association lines are solid and do not have arrows, and that's because they don't represent system flow. They only represent interaction. Next, we have relationships. Now, relationships are the connections between different use cases, such as extend, include, and generalize. It also refers to connections between actors. Now, the include relationship is any functionality that is shared between one or more use cases. The include use cases is a required function and must be completed in order for the base use case to be successfully executed. Include relationships are represented with dashed lines with an arrow pointing from the base use case toward the included use case. An extended relationship can be any additional functionality to a base use case. When used this way, the extended use case can be optional and does not impact the execution of the base use case. Now, extended use cases can also be an exception to a base use case. Extended use cases are also represented with a dashed line, but these have arrows pointing toward the base use case from the extended use case. Now, the next relationship we have is generalization. This is the relationship between two use cases when a child use case inherits the functionality of the parent use case. Now, the child use case is also more specialized and includes specific functionality. This is used when two or more use cases have common behavior. Now, in order to provide examples of these relationships, it's necessary to define the term base use case. So the base use case is the main use case that has a particular goal. It may use the functionality of another use case in an include relationship, or it may utilize optional or exception functionality in the extend relationship. Now, a base use case can also be the parent use case to one or more child use cases in a generalization relationship. Now, the generalization relationship can also apply to actors, where the child actors inherit the general functionality of a parent actor. So for example, you may have a general customer actor, and that role may be segmented into two different levels of authorization. So the regular customer might inherit the general customer capabilities, but they'll also have maybe additional capabilities and privileges for maintaining their service. The new customer, on the other hand, may have limited functionality or capabilities. So while they are inheriting the general customer functionality, they may have deposit or withdrawal limitations for a short period of time. Now let's look at goals. The goal is the end result of key use cases. Now, various scenarios may occur within a use case, but the goals are represented through the naming convention of the use case in a verb noun format. So for example, complete is your verb and online transaction is your noun. So the goal here is to fully execute or complete the online transaction. And a general rule when determining which use cases to use in a use case diagram is to identify the requirements that enable the user to achieve a particular goal. Now let's take a look at the use case diagram of a banking system. So to start, we're using the banking system to define the boundary of our solution. Then we have our system name here at the top center of the system boundary box, which is banking system. Next, we have our actors. As you can see, we have our primary actors on the left and our secondary actors on the right. Here we have our customer as a general actor and our new and regular actors as our child actors. We also have our bank employee as our secondary actor who may have some type of interaction with the online transactions. And we also have our external database that might also interact with the online transaction, likely to pull or store data. Then we have our use cases. Our base use cases are complete online transaction and complete mobile transaction. And we also have several sub use cases. Now, the online payments and online transfers are two variations of the complete online transaction use case. Since this is a generalization relationship, they inherit the functionality and relationships of the complete online transaction use case. Then we have our login use case, which is an included relationship to both the complete online transaction use case and the complete mobile transaction use case. This means that both of these use cases require the login functionality in order to be successfully executed. Then we have our invalid login, which is an exception to the login use case. Notice we have several association lines between the actors and the base use cases. And again, we have our relationships. Here we have the include relationship, an extension relationship, as well as a generalization relationship. We also have a generalization ship between the actors. So now that you know the components of a use case and how to interpret it, let's look at some best practices. So first, you want to be sure to keep use case names short and simple. These diagrams are intended to simplify complex information. Also, your use case names should include a verb and a noun. So use case naming should be action-oriented. Verbs convey action, which is why we have actors. Then, be sure to model functionality from the user perspective. The purpose is to illustrate how a user interacts with the solution. Also, human actors should be notated as roles and not names. In general, system functionality is role-based, not individual-based. Then, be sure to position actors and use cases logically. Now, while use cases don't show flow or sequence, having the use cases logically placed can make it easier to interpret. Also, only model key functionality that enables user goals. Not all features or requirements will need to be illustrated in the use case diagram. Only those that have clear goals or relationships with those use cases. And finally, do not try to model detailed flows or sequence. This type of detail is better suited for flow diagrams or sequence diagrams. Well, there you have it, folks. That's what you need to know in order to create clear and simple use case diagrams. If you learned something new, tell me about it in the comments. I'd love to hear your feedback. Also, be sure to check out all the business analysis and BA certification training we have for you at thebadoc.com. That's thebadoc.com. Thank you so much for watching. Be sure to have a productive and prosperous day, and I'll see you next time. Bye now.